Some people call them number talks, but showing your students a series of problems or visuals during math and then investigating the relationship between those problems is actually doing number strings. I'm Christina Tonneval, the Recovering Traditionalist, and today we're going to take a look at what are number strings and how to make them in our quest to build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our kiddos. So to start off with, I want to explain just briefly what I mean by it's not a number talk, it's a number string. I have another video all about the difference between number talks and number strings, so we'll make sure to link that up down below. But really briefly, the original number talks were by Kathy Richardson and Ruth Parker, and they talked about it as a number talk is one problem or one visual, and then you talk about all the different ways that kids see that or think about it or solve the problem. A number string is typically a series, like a string of problems or visuals that are related in some ways. It's been kind of talked about as like people interchange those because there was a book called Number Talks that is a lot of they're really strings within that book. So I just want to clarify a little bit before we get started. And if you want to dive deeper into that, go check out the other video that I did about the difference between number talks and number strings. So a number string is a series of problems that are related in some way. Typically, there's what I like to call a helper problem. And I think that term originated from Kathy Fosnow. Kathy Fosnow that was the first place I ever learned about them. She called them mini lessons, but other people call them problem strings, number strings. But Kathy Fosnow was where I originally learned about them in her mini lessons. And I'll link again, I'll share some places that you can get more information about hers as well. So there is a helper problem that is typically something that your students know quickly. And then you show a problem that relates to that helper problem, and you discuss what kind of relationships kids are seeing. You don't want to point them out. You want to be asking questions and getting the kids to talk about what relationships they see, which is why I like to start out with visual ones first, but depends upon your grade level. But most kids always need to start out with visuals. I'll show you some here in just a moment. So you do a helper problem, and then kind of a harder problem, but it relates to the helper problem. And then you're going to give a similar kind of helper problem, and then one that relates to that. So let's say your textbook, for anybody who does younger grades, our textbooks try to teach our students doubles plus one for addition. Use a double and you can chunk out the one, right? So if it's 6 plus 7, just think about that as 6 plus 6 plus an extra one. Well, a lot of kids don't see how 6 plus 7 relates to 6 plus 6, even though we do a couple lessons from the textbook. So you can create visuals that show like a 3 plus 3, that's a 6, and then a 3 plus 4, that's a 3 plus 3 plus 1, right? So you're helping them see the numbers within, you're helping them see the doubles. I could show a 6 plus 6. And then show 6 plus 7, but visually to help them see the 6 within the 7, right? So you're starting with a helper problem, the 6 plus 6, that's one that they should quickly know, and then you're showing the double plus 1 afterwards, okay? So that's the main idea. You're doing a few of those where the helper problem, then the problem you're trying to help them see how it relates to another problem. And you keep doing a double and then a double plus 1, a double and then a double plus 1, a double, and then a double plus 1. And then you might, depending upon your time frame and how often you do these, you might have just a couple problems that are doubles plus 1. So you might just show a couple of those without showing the helper problem first. Okay? So that's kind of the typical makeup of number strings. So they can be with images or they can be with abstract symbols. So here's some examples from a slide deck that we have created for our members of the Build Math Minds PD site. There are over 100 and some slides in this slide deck of number strings, but here is one that is showing a visual of a very popular multiplication strategy. So our textbooks will try to get kids to use, you know, if you are doing 9 times something, just think about it as 10 times something and then subtract out the extra. But that's really hard for kids to visualize. So you build a string around it. And so I show 10 groups of 4, and then I show 9 groups of 4. And we have a discussion about what's the same, what's different, how could I write this? What kind of multiplication problem are we showing in each of these? How could we write this with symbols? And then I'm going to show the next one here that is 10 groups of 6 and then 9 groups of 6. And then I might show another one of 10 groups of 3 and then 9 groups of 3. And then to kind of finish this string, I might show one without a helper problem, and I'll just put up 9 groups of 5, and I'll ask them, so based upon what we've talked about in this string, what's a way that we could think about this problem to help us out? If we don't instantly know 9 groups of 5, instead of counting all those dots, how could I think about this problem, right? And not everybody in the class is going to come up with it, but that's why we need to do strings a lot. We need to do these visuals a lot. Get kids to notice relationships a lot. They have to do it over and over and over again, and we want them to be looking for relationships. It doesn't just happen from one lesson what we're trying to do with fact fluency to help our kids learn doubles and doubles plus one for addition or make 10 or using strategies like this for multiplication where if you have 9 groups, you could think about 10 groups. It comes from doing a lot of these over and over and over again. And again, it doesn't have to be visual. Here's an example where we kind of write it out in words. I'm still using the groups of to remind them that multiplication means groups of, that I want to elicit that visual that we have used before, that 10 groups of 6 and then 9 groups of 6. And then you can even move into strings that are very abstract like this one, 10 groups of 5, then 9, or sorry, I'm still using the groups of 10 times 5 and then just show 9 times 5 and then 10 times 8 and then 9 times 8 and you keep going. And again, you might show some without helper problems, but that's up to you. Maybe your students need those helper problems more and you're going to do some more and more number strings and then you're going to try some without the helper problems, but you do want to have at least a couple helper problems before you just jump into just tell me how you think about it. All right, so number strings are just a great 5 or 10 minute activity that you can do with your students to help them look for relationships between different visuals or problems. This is one of the best ways you can help your students discover strategies for addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division without you needing to directly teach those strategies. Kids will naturally start to develop them by using those visuals and seeing relationships within problems. Now, you can find pre-made strings just by Googling, but I want to encourage you to try to make your own. I make mine just with shapes in a slide. And I want you to make it your own because it depends upon what your students are needing and the connections and relationships that you want to help them build. Now, as I said, for those of you who are members of the Build Math Minds PD site, we do have a more in-depth video for you about number strings and a bunch of pre-made slides for addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, even fractions. But remember, I want you to kind of create your own. We're just giving you a baseline. So all of those slides that we have for our members are totally editable and you can use them as we have them, but you can also modify them to be what your students are needing at the time. So I hope that this helped you build your math mind so you can build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.